Hey, what's going on, Rattlers? So, you know, so many of you guys have asked me to show off my herp room, and, you know, I'll tell you, I'm in between trips right now. I'm about to leave for San Diego tomorrow on another awesome herping adventure, but I figured that for this week, I'm gonna give you guys a tour of my herp room.
I'm Dave Kaufman, and these are my reptile adventures.
At Zilla, we are dedicated to the innovation of caging, lighting, and equipment solutions that provide proper husbandry for your pet's long and happy life. To see our entire catalog, visit ZillaRules.com.
So as you guys know, in our hobby, there's really two different types of herpers. There's the deli cup herpers, the breeders, and then there's the field herpers. And I love both aspects of our hobby. You know, I get more excited about seeing a corn snake in the wild than I do about having a corn snake here in my family. But that being said, what I work with in my family, I work with geckos, primarily gargoyle geckos and crested geckos. Behind me in this Freedom Breeder rack are most of my ball pythons. I work almost exclusively with pieds. And if they're not pieds, then they're genes that I'm breeding into my pied projects. I also work with a lot of colubrids, and I also have a few that are just pets. So let's start off with a little hognose. So this is a lavender hognose snake. This is one of two hognose snakes that I have right now. I used to have a ton of hognose snakes, and out of the colubrids that I work with, it was hognose snakes and select king snakes and, of course, bull snakes. But you know, I've never made this public yet, but last February when the whole world froze over, you know, we got it really bad here in Minnesota. And the way that my house is set up is that at the base of the stairs down by the garage door, it usually stays 50 degrees down there, and it's a perfect place to brumate all of my colubrids. Well, during that cold snap in February, we had a power outage and our house got down to 20 degrees. And as we were scrambling to save the ball pythons with the contingency that I have for such an emergency, we have those heat packs. And as we were shaking up the heat packs and getting them onto the ball pythons, the colubrids and brumation were the last thing that I went to check on. And when I went down there, the temperature was in the teens for far too long. And I lost every single colubrid. All of my hognose snakes, some genes that no one else had, I lost. All of my Mexican black king snakes, I lost the entire colony. Bull snakes, I had genes that no one else was working with. Snakes that I raised from a baby, and I lost them all. It was the most devastating event in the 25 plus years that I've been doing this. I've never had anything like this happen. And I didn't make it public because I know our community. People would have wanted to gift me snakes, and instead, I would much rather have them make a donation to US Ark instead of gift me snakes. I will build this back up. But this one was gifted to me from Chloe's Kingdom Colubrids. Laura and Brian Brevik are great people with a great company. That they gifted me these hognoses to get me started again means the world to me. So guys, thank you so much. You didn't need to do this, but man, do we love this snake. So this is, again, only one of two hognose snakes that I work with currently because of that devastating event that happened. The other side of the coin is, because I travel so much for this channel, I can't have the amount of animals that I want, and I would love to have a facility with hundreds of ball pythons and hundreds of colubrids and hundreds of geckos, but with my travel schedule, I simply can't work with all the animals that I want to work with. I have to keep it manageable for my caretakers to care for while I'm out traveling making videos. But this is one of my remaining hognoses. It's a lavender. Lavenders are my favorite morph of hognose snake. They are just beautiful little hognose snakes. But I still do have a couple of bull snakes left. And again, sadly, I lost all of my adult bull snakes in brumation this year. I've only got a colony of five of these left, and they're going to go next year. I'm really gun-shy about brumating these guys, but this is an extremely rare morph of bull snake. This is a patternless stillwater. This is one out of only a handful in the world. And this guy was bred by Stephen Snow, who I'm pretty sure will have these again this year. But I got this guy as a baby, as a future breeder, and just look at what that Stillwater gene does to patternless. It really makes these snakes glow in the dark. It really gives them that golden yellow color that you just don't see with regular patternless bull snakes. So this, again, is an extremely rare morph of bull snake. And I'm going to breed this guy to this girl. This is another really rare morph of bull snake. This is an extreme red albino Stillwater. And so I'm going to breed this one to the patternless Stillwater, and in two generations, I will get patternless red albino Stillwater bull snakes. This is a project that I've been working on for a few years. I am really excited to get these guys paired up. And if you guys have been watching the channel for a while, then you are going to recognize this incubator. I did a video on how I made this incubator out of an old soda cooler. But right now, this incubator is full of ball python eggs. I have a very low-tech way of cataloging who was bred to who, when the eggs were laid and when they're due, and how many eggs that are there. Post-it notes, you gotta love them. I've got some Orange Dream Enchi Pied stuff coming. I've got some GHI Mojave Enchi Pieds coming in this one. In this box, I hope to have Yellow Belly Enchi Lavender Pieds. And in this one, I hope to have my first Leopard Super Banana Pied. Those will be a first for me. So again, the first eggs are due in about 3 weeks. I am really looking forward to this season with my ball pythons. And in these two cages over here from Zen Habitats, I've got my boy Ares right here that I'll take out in a second. And the enclosure below is my Burmese mountain tortoise, which I'll take out in a second as well. So Ares here is like our little reptile dog. Of course I got him from Thai Park a couple of years ago. And, you know, rhino iguanas, they grow fast. They're going to outgrow their enclosures. So this is Ares' second enclosure that he's had. And as he outgrows this enclosure, he's going to have the run of one of the rooms that I'm going to give him along with my tortoises. But for now, this is absolutely perfect for Ares. Ares loves this log. I have never seen an iguana love a log as much as Ares does. But let's get him out, and then I'm going to show you a trick that Ares does soon as I bring him out of the enclosure. Ares does this trick every single time we take him out of his enclosure, and that is in about 3 seconds, okay, make that 1 second, he's gonna take a big dump. So for all you guys keeping rhino iguanas out there, if you have a rhino iguana that every time you take him out of his enclosure, he poops immediately, let me know. I wonder if that is just an Ares thing or if that's every rhino iguana, but seriously, like clockwork. As soon as he's out of his cage, he takes a big dump. So I always hold a paper towel under him. But Ares is about 2 years old. Look at that big fat belly he's got. So Ares is the sweetest iguana in the world. We just absolutely love this guy. He definitely needs a nail trim. He's scratching me up quite a bit here. But you can see that once he gets out, he's just an absolute little puppy dog. So if you're raising rhino iguanas from babies like we did with Ares, you want to feed them mixed greens, squash, other vegetables, fruits. You want to feed him every day until he gets to be about 2 years old, and then you can switch to every other day. I think that obesity in reptiles is a real problem because we're overfeeding them. But this is just the sweetest little iguana. And I just love him. He loves being rubbed in the back of his neck like this. He's just getting to be a big, beautiful boy, and he is such a sweetheart. So this little guy right here is our tortoise. We don't have a name for him yet. If you can think of a name for this tortoise, leave a comment below. But this is a black Burmese mountain tortoise, and he's about 2 years old. He was actually born and raised right here in Minnesota. So being a mountain tortoise, these are a little more cold tolerant than, let's say, a redfoot or a desert-dwelling tortoise like a sulcata. And these are perfect residents if you live in the north because they do tolerate cold a little bit more than other tortoises. It doesn't mean keep them cold, but they do tolerate it. His enclosure has UV and heat. So his enclosure is in the low 70s to the upper 80s. And again, we do provide him with UV light, which is really beneficial to tortoises. And he just kind of crawls around on his own. He's got like some hard water stains from his water dish there. But we just kind of open the door to his enclosure and he can crawl around on his own. And then when it's time for him to go back in, he'll just crawl back in on his own. When he gets hungry, we'll put a food dish in there. And he just crawls back into his enclosure. Whenever he's hungry, or whenever he needs to retreat from being out here in the world. All right, guys, so let's move on to the ball pythons here in the Freedom Breeder Rack. Again, I would love about 10 of these racks with about 400 snakes. Again, I have to keep my family down to a level that's manageable for my travel schedule. And again, everything in this rack are either pieds or other genes that I'm eventually going to breed into the pied gene. So two of my favorite pieds that I work with are these two albinos, but this one is just an albino pied, but this one has something else in it. So as you can see, this one is just albino pied, but this one has something else in it, and you can see those oranges coming out, and the dead giveaway is that pixelation around the saddles here. This one is a yellow belly albino pied, and again, this one is just an albino pied. But this albino yellow belly pied, she's gonna go for her first year next year, and I've got something really exciting to breed with her. So this was a snake that I imported from Europe last year. This is a phantom clown het albino. So when I breed this male to those two albino pieds, I'm gonna get phantom albinos that are double het for clown pied. I am really excited about this project. I paired this guy up with both of those females this year. They just didn't ovulate. So that project is gonna be another year, but man, it's gonna be so worth the wait. So this is the girl that started my love of pieds. This girl's name is Piggy. Well, she had that name before I got her and I just stuck with it. But I got Piggy about maybe 10 or 11 years ago. So she's about 13 years old. And even when Piggy is done breeding, she is gonna be in my family forever. She'll just be a retired breeder pet. But this is my girl. I absolutely love Piggy. She is such a good breeder. She laid 13 eggs this year. And man, I just love this snake so much. If I had to get rid of every snake that I have here except for one, Piggy would be the one that stays with me. And Piggy was bred to this guy. So I produced this snake about 2 years ago. This is a Mojave GHI Inchy Het Pied. So in Piggy's 13 egg clutch, I'm expecting a lot of GHI pieds, a lot of Mojave pieds, a lot of Inchy pieds, and a lot of combinations in those. And I'm also hoping to hit the Mojave GHI Inchy Pied. And in 13 eggs, I have a pretty good chance of hitting a few of those. And of course he's in shed right now, but when he's not, man, his darks are darks and his lights are really lights. And you can see the pattern coming up the side here, and that's what Inchy does. It puts pattern on a Mojave GHI. And if you guys have been watching the channel for a while, then you will recognize this girl. I did a video when this girl hatched because she is the weirdest ball python I have ever seen, let alone hatched. This is Pandora, and Pandora is a paradox ball python. So Piggy, as we met earlier, is her mother, but she was bred to a pastel clown. And Piggy is not het clown, and that pastel clown is not het pied, but something funky happened, and she is exhibiting a head that looks like a clown. She's obviously pastel, but if you look back here on the tail, she turns into a normal ball python here on her tail that isn't pastel. But this is one of the most interesting paradoxes I've ever seen, and she will be ready to breed for the first time this upcoming season. But look at that head markings, and look at that yellow coming out, and that funky pattern. I just absolutely love this snake. So I could make a video an hour long on just the pied morphs that I'm working with, but I want to break into that real quick to show you this girl. This is the only boa that we have in our family. This is a leucistic Colombian rainbow boa. And I just love rainbow boas. So we've got snakes that are breeders, and we also have snakes that are just our pets. And this girl was gifted to me, and I really wasn't sure what I was gonna do with her because I don't work with boas, I don't work with rainbow boas. But we just fell in love with her, and now she is just a pet. I don't think I'm ever gonna breed her. Her name is Snow, and again, she's a leucistic Colombian rainbow boa. So this is the only retic that I have in my family. This is a super dwarf retic, of course from Garrett Hartle. But this snake has a really interesting story in that she's a parthenogenesis snake, which means she never had a father. Her mother was never with a male, and that mother laid 3 eggs, and those eggs were fertile, and Cat here hatched out of one of those eggs. And the sad thing about parthenogenesis is sometimes the snakes don't live for very long. We expected Cat here to live for maybe 6 months. and she's now almost at her third birthday. I have no intentions to breed Cat. She is just a pet, and she is just a sweetheart of a retic, as you can see. She has a bit of a food response, so I have to be careful opening her enclosure. But again, she's a super dwarf, and she's about 3 years old, but look at how small she is for 3 years old. She should be much bigger than she is. She eats regularly. She eats just fine. She's just not putting on that size. And I think that has to do with her being a parthenogenesis snake. But she is such a sweetheart, and we absolutely love this snake. So let's move on to my geckos. So a while ago, I did an unboxing video where I unboxed this guy, who was a gift from Edgar at Gecko Gen. And I just wanted to show him off to show you guys how big and beautiful this gargoyle gecko has gotten. But look at those colors coming through. He is just an absolute gorgeous gecko. And this guy turned out to be a male, so I'm always on the lookout for females to put this guy with. But this is one of about a half a dozen gargoyle geckos that I have now. In about 6 months, I'm looking to have a colony of over 50 of these. So our gargoyle geckos and our crested geckos that we have here are on a diet of Pangaea. They love the stuff with the insects, but I also supplement them with crickets and roaches as well. And I think that a lot of crested gecko and gargoyle gecko keepers neglect to give them live insects. And what live insects do is it gives them a lot of protein, but it also gives them enrichment, because at night they don't want to hunt for Pangaea diet, they want to hunt for crickets. And with the Pangaea diet, all I do is give them a constant access to it and swap that out almost every single day so that they have fresh food available to them at all times. And I keep these guys in Zilla front opening cages, but as other keepers may set these guys up in a bioactive enclosure, I don't do that. There's no reason why I don't, I just don't. But I keep each gecko in their own separate enclosure until I'm going to pair them up for breeding. So guys, there's a little sample of what we have in our reptile family here. You know, I'll tell you, I love traveling the world. I love herping. I love seeing these guys in the wild. But again, the downside is that with my travel schedule, I can't have the hundreds of snakes and the hundreds of geckos that I really want to work with. That will come one day because, listen, I will run out of places to travel in the world, but I'm never going to stop making these videos. Anyway, guys, there are many more reptile adventures coming up from all over the world. So as always, hit that subscribe button. Give this video a like, and guys, thanks for watching, and until the next reptile adventure, love the planet, feed your reptile obsession, and rattle on.